Welcome to the Modern Health Show. This is fitness and nutrition expert Shawn Stevenson here with my amazing, gorgeous, talented co-host and the producer of the Model Health Show, dancing as always.
Yeah,
Jade.
As always, right.
Harrell.
Hi.
How's it going? What's up, Jade?
What's up, Shawn?
How are you today?
Today I am Loveeceville.
Loveeceville?
Yes.
Okay. I'm really curious on this. What does this mean?
Peaceful, lovely, and tranquil today.
Loveeceville.
Loveeceville.
Now that sounds like some. That's I like that.
I'm speaking it forth because it was a
that's
hectic morning.
Rico suave.
That's it.
Right there. I like it.
I love that song.
Well, everybody, thank you so much. Right.
It was so good. Right?
What is his name?
You felt cool.
Geraldo, something like that.
I think so. I think it was.
Yeah. He had the holy pants, the
right.
tight.
But he was
came
cool.
back. But he had the cowboy boots though.
See?
Right?
That's how you Midwestern.
How you gonna rock the cow with the gang bandana?
Exactly.
All right. Yes.
Suave.
Shout out to Rico Suave. Everybody, thank you so much for tuning into the show today. We've got an amazing guest, an amazing topic,
yeah.
something I'm very, very excited to talk about, and something that surprisingly is largely overlooked mm-hmm. when we talk about health, period. When we talk about just really what's going on and how our culture impacts our brains and how it impacts our health and how it impacts our performance, our sex, our success in life. Was that a Freudian slip?
Yeah.
Right there. So.
I think we've got that perfect, mentioned in almost every episode.
Perfect example.
Yeah.
I just left early this morning. Mm-hmm. My son had some public speaking. My youngest son, who is 5 years old.
Really?
Right. So at their school, he goes to this Montessori school and they mm-hmm. They have the kids speaking, doing public speaking very early on.
That's
so he's in preschool still because he's at the cutoff. He's not even in kindergarten yet. Mm-hmm. And so everybody just heard him recently on an episode, our live episode from Washington, D.C., which we'll put in the show notes if you happen to have missed it.
It
is hashtag classic. All right. And he got up on stage and he did his thing.
Yeah,
but he's in that environment and he sees his dad speaking up and he's right there doing the same thing.
That's right.
So he was practicing his line mm-hmm. and he had his line down backward and forwards, a couple of lines, actually. And last night I had him to really push out his voice, right? So, and I kept backing away, getting further and further away from him in the house to make sure that I can hear him.
Nice drill.
Right? Yeah. So I kept backing up and he would do it again and he'd be projecting more and more. All right.
Good.
So that's what I want you to do tomorrow. When you get on stage, project.
Yeah.
So cut to today. All the kids are, you know, stepping up to the microphone and, well, I'm sorry, they're not stepping up to the microphone, stepping to the front of the stage and they're giving their line and something like this.
That's right.
And I'm just like, wow, okay. But everybody's clapping, supporting, because the little kids and they're, you know, they're just doing their thing. And then Brayden steps up. I'm like, all right, here we go. He's gonna broadcast it. Here we go. And he's like, the land is
where
our roots are. And I was like, oh, buddy, it's okay. You know, I clapped it up for him. And we got back in. I gave him the double thumbs up. Not just the one, gave him the double thumbs up.
And I know he was looking for you.
Yes, of course, of course.
Yeah.
But it's a perfect example of the cultural mm-hmm. influence. He did what the rest of the kids were doing, even though he had this idea mm-hmm. and this maybe even a desire to do something else.
Exactly.
Right? And so that's happening to us unconsciously all the time mm-hmm. and at a very deep level. Even when we're talking about the health of our cells. So today's guest is just going to blow your mind. But before we get to him, really quickly, I want to give a shout out to our favorite green juice superfood supplement, Organifi, that I give my kids every day.
Mm-hmm.
And actually, Brayden had it last night, right before we did his little going through his lines.
That's right.
And so because it actually tastes good, and that's mm-hmm. one of the things that really makes Organifi stand out. I've tried dozens and dozens and dozens of green superfood blends over the years. I've been in the game for a long time. And some of them do taste like, I don't know, cat hair or something. I don't know. It doesn't taste that great, but you know, you do it for the health benefits.
Yeah.
But this one has the organic spirulina, organic mm-hmm. wheatgrass, organic chlorella, right? And we already know spirulina is one of my favorite things. 70% protein by weight. Rare source of something called phycocyanin.
Mm-hmm.
Phycocyanin, which is clinically proven to help your body to mobilize and to release stem cells, right? Stem cells.
Right.
This is
literally,
these are the building blocks or the roots of becoming any cell that your body needs.
Mm-hmm.
So if you need more cartilage somewhere, if you need a little bit more muscle tissue, if you even need a little fat
That's
somewhere,
right.
stem cells are important. Like, da-da-da.
I can lend a little something to that conversation.
And it has all of this, plus the ashwagandha, plus the coconut water, which makes it taste phenomenal, and the mint. So head over, check it out. Mm-hmm. It's Organifi.com/model. That's Organifi.com/model. You're going to get 20% off of your Organifi green superfood blend. So make sure that you're utilizing that on a daily basis like we are. And on that note, let's get to the iTunes review of the week.
All right, this one is really nice. 5 stars, upgrades, and entertainment. Shawn and Jade, I cannot begin to thank you enough for this show. I've been listening for about 6 months, and I'm so glad I found it. I call it a wealth of knowledge, and that is an understatement. I love the guests you have and all the amazing information and research and ideas that you provide, as well as your guests. I also love geeking out with you on some of the science, but it wouldn't be nearly as interesting if you didn't also make it so fun and upbeat. Mostly, I love the show because it provides inspiration. Whenever I need a reminder or a kick in the pants, I put it on and head out for a long run. By the time I'm done, I'm pumped and I'm ready to keep working on the best version of myself. I envy you for the satisfaction you get from helping so many others and would love to be able to do so as well. But I'm also thankful I'm one. Thanks again. You rock. My best, Mike.
Mike, thank you. I received that, man. Thank you so much for sharing that. And you put a smile on my face for the day. I truly, truly do appreciate that. And everybody, thank you for leaving those reviews on iTunes. Keep them coming. Head over to iTunes. Leave us that review so we can make sure the show is getting to more and more people. And on that note, let's get to our special guest and our topic of the day. Today's guest is Dr. Mario Martinez, and he's a licensed clinical psychologist and best-selling author of 2 books, The Mind-Body Code, How to Change the Beliefs That Limit Your Health, Longevity, and Success, and the psychological novel, where he's imbuing science into a fictional story, The Man from Autumn. He lectures worldwide on his pioneering work in biocognitive science, a new mind-body paradigm that investigates the inherited causes of health and how our cultural beliefs affect our immune, nervous, and endocrine systems. Based on how the immune system makes decisions under conditions of uncertainty, Dr. Martinez has developed a unique model of organizational science he calls the Empowerment Code to teach executives of global companies how to maximize productivity while enhancing wellness. You can find out more about him and his work at biocognitive.com. And I'd like to welcome to the Model Health Show, Dr. Mario Martinez. How are you doing today, Mario?
Doing great and very pleased that I'm going to be on your show.
Oh, the pleasure is all ours. We're very, very excited to have you. And first and foremost, I'd love to get a little bit more information on your superhero background, right? Your superhero origin story. Because the science and the work that you're doing today is really in a league of its own. So I'm curious, how did you get interested in psychology and health in the first place?
Well, first, my mother wanted me to be an engineer like my grandfather, and I went to the University of Madrid to do engineering, and that wasn't my world. So I failed miserably, purposely, and I came back to the States, and she said, well, okay, do anything you want except psychology. So that was the beginning. And then I was very fortunate to have really, really good mentors, people who were pioneers in their fields. John Bransford at Vanderbilt, who debunked Skinner, and then later George Solomon, who created psychoneuroimmunology. And these people were so humble and so wonderful. They always said, I'm really excited to work with you. Let's see what we can learn and do together and have a lot of fun. These were incredible people. So they taught me a lot of humility that sometimes I forget. But basically, the idea is that I was always very interested in why is it that when people know already what they need to do that's best for them, stop smoking, drugs, or bad relationships, why is it that they don't do it? It's not because they're pathological or because they're lacking intelligence. There's more to that. And that's why the Mind-Body Code, the first book that I wrote, was about that, to talk about how the brain or the mind communicates with your biology. Then later, as you mentioned, the Mind-Body-Self, which is the new book, I talk about how that communication is really structured and molded by our culture. And that's the part that's missing in psychoneuroimmunology. It's mind, body, and culture. And I'll go over that as we move along the program. But that's basically the idea, that bringing bringing the presence to culture that it requires in the process of healing and longevity and health.
Yes. Well, I'm very, very excited because that's really where my work has been over the years. You know, the tactics to get things done for somebody to change their health, they're very, very simple. And they're also very well known. So why don't people do them? And for you to really dive in and to do the research to answer that question, like, we know what to do, why don't we do it, is incredibly exciting. But before we get to it, you just said an important word that I want to just kind of give a little bit more information on. Psychoneuroimmunology. What the heck is that?
Well, back in the 60s, George Solomon, who's a research psychiatrist, thought that there was more to autoimmune illnesses, for example, with rheumatoid arthritis. And he found that it wasn't just the rheumatoid factor. There were women that were having the symptoms and the expression of the illness without the factor. Some with the factor were not having it. So he found that there were psychological processes that influenced the expression of an illness. And he called it psychoimmunology at the time. And they almost laughed him out of UCLA because, you know, when you try to shift the paradigm, you get a lot of disdain at first. Right. Then later, not only they confirmed that, but also confirmed that the nervous system, so they called it psychoneuroimmunology. Then the endocrine system, they call it psychoneuroimmunoendocrinology, and on and on and on. So basically, one day I called George Solomon and said, look, I have the word for it. And he said, how long is it? So I said, it's biocognition. He said, well, it's not bad. But the idea is to bring psychoneuroimmunology to the next level, which is the cultural psychoneuroimmunology, because it studies, unfortunately, mostly college students with some levels of anxiety, rats and so forth, which is good, but is not sufficient because it doesn't consider the cultural components of the process of mind and body.
Yeah, so that's what I want to talk about next, is actually how culture is influencing these things, because so many of us have been indoctrinated with this idea that our genes are really our lot in life. You know, what our genes are saying is how things are going to be experienced. It's basically what we're inherited. So let's dive in and talk about that. Why is longevity specifically, why is it culturally learned rather than inherited?
Well, when I first started studying centenarians, people over 100, I was very interested in looking at longevity, but healthy longevity. So I looked at centenarians that were healthy. Some of them were living alone, but they were not vegetating in hospices and hospitals. So I came in with the idea that genes were really, if you have the genetic predisposition or if you have the genetic endowment, then that's it, you're going to live long. And after studying hundreds of these centenarians, I found that at most 25% has to do with genetics. The rest is the culture beliefs that I found out later, and the way that they live, the way they view the world. And based on that, I developed the biocognitive theory, but had to come up with a new language, because the old language, the reductionist language, would not really express the things that I was learning about. So one of the things that I learned is that the brain is really very cultural. The brain will adjust to the cultural beliefs. And what is a culture? A culture is basically, it's the collectively learned propensity to perceive the world. So you have a propensity to perceive the world. And I'll give you something very specific. In some countries, when women have menopause and they have the hot flashes, in Latin America, they call it bochorno, which means shame. We know now that shaming someone causes inflammation. If someone shames you, you will have inflammation as if you had some kind of infection. You have interleukins and you have tumor necrosis factors and other kinds of molecules that cause inflammation. So these women, and even the doctors will say, oh, she's having the symptoms of shame or bochorno. Well, these women have lower self-esteem, more inflammation, more pain, and more related problems with the menopause and the hot flashes than women, here's the culture, than women in Japan that call it konenki, which means a second spring. Mm-hmm. Those women have higher self-esteem, lower levels of inflammation, because they're going into a place of wisdom and a resource for the communities. Completely cultural, affecting your biology.
Whoa.
Holy guacamole. First of all, this is like profound, because yeah, of true. How we, The thing is, we can consciously try and label something differently, but if it's culturally integrated, that is a whole other can of potatoes in and of itself, because I don't think that's easily shifted in our, and so is this, this is a good space.
No, and that's a great question. I'll tell you why, though, at least I believe. It's because we learn things in clusters.
Yeah.
We learn the cognitive component. We learn the biological component, what the immune system does to it, the nervous system, so forth. And then we try to intellectually change that cluster. So that's only a part of the cluster. So if we say, I'm a good person, and you have a history of not being a good person, and you have a biology of not being a good person, it's not going to buy it. So it doesn't work. Affirmations alone don't work. But if you embody it with the methods that I've been developing, then yes, then it works. So I'll give you a simple example of what to do, because biocognition really takes complex processes and makes them very simple so they can be applicable and you can use them. So let's say that you tell yourself, I'm a good person, and your culture tells you that you're not. All right, you say, I'm a good person, and instead of repeating it, you go to your body to see how your body's responding to that. And you might find a little bit of tension around your chest, or you might have your saliva will dry up. All of these things that are coming up that are saying, no, you're not, your history says you're not a good person. Then you stop, and how do you change it? You go back to some archive, you go back to some memory that allowed you to see that you have evidence that at some point you were a good person. So you go back and you realize that way back you actually helped a friend of yours that needed some help, and you felt really good about it. You bring that feeling, emotion, cognition back, and you experience it. After you experience it, then you have the signature of what it is to be a good person and the signature of what it is to be a bad person. But the brain needs evidence. That the brain does not function just with you giving it cognitive information. So then what you do, you make a commitment that day to do things to create evidence that you're a good person. Then your neuromaps begin to change, and then you can go against the culture and you become an outlier.
You just said it. And I was just watching something from Malcolm Gladwell, who kind of coined that term, well, pushed that into culture, mm-hmm. you know, being yes. an outlier and making it more attractive. Because even hearing that word, though, when we talk about mm-hmm. culture, being an outlier doesn't necessarily sound exciting, or it might not be something that we are all kind of inclined to do. So why would we be motivated to do that?
Well, at first, what happens is that the culture is very collectivist, even in individualist country. The cultures were made to stay within the pale, within the enclosure, to protect you and to work for the collective good of the culture. When you try to get out, and even if you do well, you are beyond the pale. And beyond the pale has kind of a negative connotation, which is actually not bad if you're doing the right things. But what the culture will do then, implicitly, it will wound you with one of the three archetypal wounds that I found all across cultures. It would either abandon you, it would betray you, or it would shame you. So not even consciously, you know you're getting away. And one of the things that I've done with some country music stars and people that have come from very humble environments, and they become a success, not overnight, but a success. Then they go back to their environments, and at first they're the heroes and they're wonderful. But after a while, they start bringing them down. Oh, you haven't been over to visit. Are you too good for us? So what I found is that in order for them to get back and be accepted again, they either lose the money they make, they go into drugs, they go into bad relationships, and they come back broken, and then the culture takes them back and helps them. So it's some dynamics that need to be worked out in order to be an outlier without getting sick.
Wow. You just said, like, that's like 50% of movies right there, you know, where somebody makes it, and, you know, that whole thing of, like, you forgot where you came from.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
You know, and so I'm very curious as I'm hearing this, you know, a lot of different things are coming up for me, and just thinking about all the situations that I've seen personally and also in the lives of all the people I've worked with over the years, I think it's important for people to know that that's coming, right? So is it like built into the system, and how can we avoid having that take us down?
Yes, you're right. It is built into the system. And what happens is the cultures will teach you pseudo-humbleness, false humbleness, in order to keep you within. A little girl says to her mother, look, mommy, look how pretty I am. And the mother will say, no, darling, you never say that. You wait for people to tell you, and then you deny it. Mm. So it's a setup. So what I found from centenarians is that they have that sense of accepting their greatness in a very humble way, which sounds paradoxical, but it's not. I interviewed a 102-year-old woman, and she was really beautiful. And I said, you know, you're a beautiful woman. And she says, yes, I know I am. I was beautiful even when I was a little girl. Refreshing. And that's the kind of thing that we need to learn. Not to boast, but when somebody says, hey, you're brilliant. Thank you. Yes, I appreciate that. Why? Because you're creating brilliance in a contextual way. Mm. If somebody sees brilliance, that means they're brilliant. So why would you deny a gift of somebody saying to you, I love your hair, or I love the way you talk, or whatever? That's the first thing to do. And second, then you have to create the subcultures of wellness that support your brilliance, that support your greatness, and that allow you to expand as an outlier, because we're social beings. We need people to support our beliefs and to confirm our beliefs. And that's what I do in my work, trying to create these subcultures of wellness that allow people to be the best they can be.
I love that, subcultures of wellness. Yeah. And I also, you know, there's a kind of tipping point, right? Theory that once a certain amount of people or a certain percentage of people are implementing a certain behavior or a certain way of thinking, the culture shifts over to that dominant way of being. You know, so that's really what the outliers are. That's what every single person listening to the show, you have that within you. By being a part of this, inherently, for you to be an outlier, for you to be somebody who is really kind of stepping out of the normal paradigm of culture right now, which is very abnormal, and showing yes. another way. And so,
yes, and that comes from it's called the 100 monkeys rule yeah. from psychology.
yeah.
In World War II, very quickly, they were bombing, the U.S. was bombing some islands around the Philippines and so forth, and they cut the food supply for monkeys. So monkeys could no longer get their food and they were dying. So the soldiers would come and drop food, bananas and things, on the sand. But monkeys are very clean and they don't eat anything that's dirty. So there were the bananas there, sandy bananas, and nobody would touch them. Then a female monkey comes up, washes the banana, peels it and eats it. Then another monkey does it, another monkey does it. When they got to about 100 monkeys, all the monkeys around all the islands began to do it in what Sheldrake calls the morphic field, and I call it the bioinformational field. So later, some psychologists tested that, and they said, okay, well, if we can get that information out to the group, how would that be implemented? So what they did is a very clever, simple experiment. They had one group of people try to work out crossword puzzles the day that the paper came out, and another group the day after the paper came out, which the group or the world already had the solutions. And they found that the people that actually did the puzzle after the paper came out a day later did better than the ones who were doing it before the information was out into the morphic field.
So now you're talking about this morphic field and kind of how we're connected. And there's yes. a lot of data out there about this, you know, even with the U.S. military and looking at how, you know, if two people are just even creating rapport for a few minutes and then their brains literally start to sync up, right? And you can separate them and put them in different rooms and have one of the subjects exposed to stimuli that maybe, you know, it's something emotional, maybe they give them some shock therapy or whatever, but they would find that the other person's brain who they just got connected with, their brains would light up as if it was happening to them, right?
Yes.
Crazy stuff.
Many terms that show that, yes.
Crazy stuff, absolutely amazing. And this is, the thing is, like, this sounds like Matrix level stuff, like future, but it's real, this is now, and there's this, and what's happening now and what's so great about Dr. Martinez's work is that he's stepping in and affirming and finding out what are the underlying mechanisms behind this stuff and doing work to explain it to the rest of us. So you mentioned the centarians. So I want to talk a little bit about that. But specifically, first thing is why the causes of health. You talk about something called the causes of health. We usually hear about causes of illness. So why do you call it the yes. causes of health and that they are inherited? And what do we need to do to trigger them?
Okay. Part of biocognition indirectly tries to challenge all the myths of what I would call reductionist or conventional science. And what happens is if you look at the anthropology of human beings as Homo sapiens, we've been around for 150,000 years, maybe a little bit less. And we have been doing trial and error to maintain our health, to maintain our resilience. We're not learning to be sick. We're learning to be healthy. Now, that doesn't work. That doesn't mean that we're just going to, because we inherit the causes of health, they're going to come out naturally. They have to be triggered. They have to be brought out. And I'll give you an example. One of the causes of health is setting emotional limits. Letting know people how far you can go without beginning to sabotage yourself, without beginning to hurt yourself, with the exceptions of emergencies and so forth. In fact, there were some studies, and especially George Solomon did, he was looking at the HIV positive patients, and he measured their T cells, which are the ones that the virus attacks and makes the that learned immunity. And he found that the HIV positive patients who were more assertive, which means that they can set limits, had more T cells than the ones that were not that assertive and could not set limits. So what that means is the immune system responds to the consciousness that you presented. And that's good news.
That is, like, you're blowing my mind here, Gay.
Yeah, me too.
Because it's right. These are things that we, when you say it, it's like, but of course, that just makes sense. You know, but to actually have the research to back up that idea, it's something that we generally know. And it's really a result of our disposition in life, you know, our worldview, our perception of reality. And I was surprised when you said that one, even though I read your book, that setting emotional boundaries, because I'm still caught up on the cause of health being related to nutrition, being related to exercise and stress management and all those things. But there's things that govern those yes. aspects of our lives. And one of those is setting those emotional limits.
Exactly. Because those things that you mentioned are necessary, but not sufficient. And especially since here's another another cause of health is rituals. And what the way I found that out is I went to Cuba and other places where there are a lot of centenarians and Sardinia. And I would ask people, so what is it that you do that has meaning, that has sense for you? I didn't want to bias it in any way. What do you do on a regular basis that you find to be important to you? And rather than what's your secret of health or things like that. So one of them, this 101-year-old woman said, well, I have a shot of rum before I go to sleep. Mm-hmm. So I thought, oh, it's got to be some quality in the rum. Then another one, oh, I have a cigar when I wake up in the morning. Oh, it's got to be the – and what I found was that this is the ritual, the reverence you give to a routine, but you never abuse it. I never found an abusive, addictive centenarian. And I would ask him, how many shots of rum do you have? One. Why? That's all I want. So they do things that they love, not things that they need. So that having rituals is extremely important. And what's the difference between a ritual and a routine? You take a shower to stay clean. A routine is something that you do to maintain the status quo. But what if you gave reverence to that shower and you were bathing yourself and cleaning yourself in order to be cleansed of mind, body, and give it, like, for example, the ritual of having tea, then it becomes a ritual rather than a routine. And that is one of the causes of health.
I love that. Yeah. Making that bridge, because that's exactly what I was going to ask you about was, how can people transform their routines, and is it possible for them to become rituals? And very much so. And I think it's because, and when that happens, it becomes more deeply ingrained in your psychology and who you are. And you also develop a very strong passion towards doing it. So for me, I have a morning water ritual. You know, every single day I get up and I drink, you know, about a liter of high quality structured water. And even doing that process, you know, there's certain things that I'm saying in my mind. There's I'll do a little bit of movement and things like that. But I'm just really embracing the fact of how clean this is making my body and starting me off fresh for the day. Not in just a kind of a, like I just took a shower way, but I have a clean slate. And so is that the same thing?
Yes, because one is repetition and the other one is meaningful events.
Yeah.
And that is so important. The meaning is really important in the process. The immune system has morals. It responds to the morality that you assimilate from your culture and the morality that you choose to live. And I'll give you a really simple example. It's not so simple, but it's amazing, and you don't see it anywhere. It should be written on every newspaper and journal. When Aristotle talked a lot about pleasure, but there were also other philosophers that talked about hedonism. And one of the philosophers said that our purpose in life is to have pleasure, and that's it. And whatever pleasure you have, that's good. Well, now, after all these over 2,000 years, we found that Aristotle was right, because Aristotle said it's not just pleasure, it's pleasure with meaning. One is hedonistic, and the other one is pleasure with meaning. And what they found with the immune system is that when you have pleasure, just for pleasure, something called CTRA, which is a set of clusters of the immune function that it's antiviral, anti-inflammation, and also a way to function better overall, the CTRA goes down in a negative way when you have hedonistic pleasure. But if you have what they call eudemonic pleasure, which is the pleasure with meaning, the CTRA goes toward the enhancement of the immune system. So you can, the immune system is responding to a morality higher than ourselves.
Wow. That's incredibly powerful and empowering as well, that we can consciously attach meaning to things to really change our experience physically, mentally, the whole shebang. And before we get to the next thing I want to ask you about, because I want to talk more about the outliers and the wisdom of the outliers, we're going to take a quick break. So sit tight, everybody. We'll take a quick break and we'll be right back. Massive research is now pouring in with this blossoming field of science and nutrition called nutrigenomics. And this field is studying how every single molecule of food that you eat impacts your genetic expression. So we're literally talking about how your body appears, your health, or lack thereof. All of this is going to be determined by every single molecule of food that you eat. So whether it's a banana or a donut or a Hot Pocket, whatever it might be, we have to be in tune with the fact that this is going to impact what genes are getting expressed. And there are genes like the FTO gene, for example, that has been found to be this, quote, fat gene and have a high propensity towards obesity if you carry this gene. Now, you can silence these genes by making sure that you're eating real foods that are in alignment with your own genetic integrity. The basis of that needs to be from earth-grown nutrients, things that your body actually recognizes as real food that you have a history with, that your ancestors have a history with, not things that have been invented in a laboratory like last week. All right, so we want to make sure that we're eating real food that are from earth-grown nutrients. And this is why I love Onnit so much. This is why they are family. This is why I endorse them so powerfully, because they are part of my life. They're a part of my family's life. And I want to make sure that you head over to onnit.com/model. That's onnit.com/model. And you're going to get 10% off all of their health and human performance supplements. I'm a huge fan of the hemp force protein. I've been using it for many years. It's one of my favorite things in the world. And I give this to my kids as well. And this is one of the things that I love to have post-workout. Now, hemp is based on some powerful amino acids, some powerful protein building blocks like albumin, which is a very soft globular protein that's very easy to digest, plus edestin. And this is a unique protein compound that's found in hemp that might be the most bioavailable, usable protein for the human body. Crazy, right? So a lot of people today are hearing about the benefits of hemp, hemp seeds and hemp protein and hemp oil, things like that. We want to make sure, again, that you're getting organic and that it's made with integrity, right? So that this cold process, so that you're actually able to get the nutrients that you're looking for in this kind of protein powder, protein cake that you're getting with Hemp Force protein from Onnit. So they've got multiple flavors. They've got the Choco Maca. They've got the Vanilla Acai. And they also have a brand new recovery protein that adds in the powerful component of colostrum, which has every single amino acid, every polysaccharide, aka essential sugar, and every essential fatty acid right there in it. These powerful building blocks, growth factors, every growth factor that influences your body's metabolism is there in that protein, the recovery protein. So make sure that you're checking that out as well. Super powerful stuff. Also has immune factors to help fortify your immune system. Just great stuff. And they've got exercise equipment, tons of great foods. Head over, check them out today. Onnit.com/model. onnit.com/model for 10% off. Now back to the show. All right, we are back and we're talking with the one and only Dr. Mario Martinez, and he's breaking down some stuff for us today. And I'm just really interested. We were talking about outliers a little bit earlier and making that jump out of what you called this cultural pale. So let's talk about some of the wisdom of the outliers.
The outliers, I think what's important is to understand that if you're not aware of the price that you could pay, it could actually work against you. Some people get sick when they come out and they start doing things as an outlier.
Yeah.
And the important thing to understand is what I said earlier, that you're going to be, or they're going to attempt to wound you with one of the three archetypal wounds, not consciously, not in a malicious way, but that's how it's set up. You're either going to be shamed, you're going to be abandoned, or you're going to be betrayed. That's the way that the culture works on it. Second, as you become an outlier, you have to really confront how your body has been used to responding to things. So if you're an outlier and you're coming away from, for example, a woman who was told that she can't go to college or that she's not smart enough because she's a woman and she has to get to marry and all the stereotype kind of thing, all the stereotypical. When you come out, you would think that this is great because then you start being an outlier and you expand your consciousness. Well, that creates anxiety, creates a tremendous amount of anxiety because you're going beyond the what I call the limits or the ceilings of abundance. And you have to learn to go beyond the ceiling of abundance. And there are techniques for that I talk about. But basically, you have to be aware that the anxiety comes when there's something new, good or bad. It's shaking up the horizons. And when you shake up the horizons, it's necessary, it's built in to create a little bit of anxiety to then let the brain know this is new information, I have to pay more attention to it. So it's very adaptive. But all those things, you become aware of it, then you learn the journey of the outlier, which is one of the workshops that I do, and the journey of the outliers to teach people how to really come out, but without getting sick, without paying the price of going through a battlefield.
Well, that takes me back to what you said about our immune system having morals then, because if we add a meaning to being an outlier, would that help our immune system respond more positively to some of the wounds that may come up against us? And then, you know, as we're looking at how we're creating a new connection or remembrance, for example, with health, say, I remember when I used to be so vibrant and healthy and love being strong, and I go back to that. Is there something that can pull me to that moment that not only helps me do it more, but also help me address those wounds and my immune system to respond positively with a moral response?
Yes. That's also an excellent question. And yes, there is a solution. And the good news is that every wound I found has an antidote, a way of healing that wound. So for abandonment, there's commitment consciousness. For shame, there's a sense of honor consciousness. And for betrayal, loyalty consciousness. So as you begin to develop those processes, for example, in relationships, let's say you have a relationship, and what happens with relationships is that we bring in our history, and we don't know that we manipulate each other with our histories. So let's say your partner has a wound of abandonment, you have a wound of shame. Without knowing it, when you get hostile and angry with each other, you start manipulating with the wounds. So the thing to do is you stop, and if you know you have a wound of abandonment, immediately you go into commitment consciousness. You bring in memory from commitments. You bring memories from things that you've done that gave you commitment. And at that moment, you make a commitment to love. And what it does is immediately it changes your psychoneuroimmunology in the sense that you're not secreting those stress hormones anymore, but you're secreting oxytocin and other kinds of hormones and processes that actually enhance immune system functioning.
Wow.
Can you do an example of that, like in a role play kind of conversation?
Yes. That's really good because I'm glad you asked me these things. Sometimes people talk about theories. Oh, this is really nice. Get in touch with the universe. No, the universe is too busy expanding. It's not going to pay a lot of attention to what you're doing. One example. You come home. Your partner's cooking for you.
Mm-hmm.
And you come home 15 minutes late. And your partner gets so angry, and you can tell you're responding to a archetypal wound because it's not commensurate with the situation. Your partner is so hostile or so angry that the question is, why would this person get so angry because I'm 15 minutes late? What your partner is doing is dumping all the history of abandonment into the situation. So if you know that, then you stop and you acknowledge that you're late not in a guilt. Okay, I'm late. I'm very sorry that I'm late. But tell me what you need from me now to show you my commitment to this relationship. Man. That person will start going, well, you're late. No, no. What do you need me to commit right now? And the person may say, give me a hug or promise you're going to be more on time, whatever. You agree to it. You touch each other. You hug to get oxytocin and the connection of the psychoneuroimmunology of it. And that resolves the situation if you're willing. Now, if you want to be a victim or a martyr, then it doesn't work.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Now, would you do the same with honor and loyalty? Would you say, what would you need me to honor?
Or yes,
what can I show you with loyalty in response to the betrayal and shame?
You bring the consciousness. And then for that day, since you know you've been disempowered for that day, okay, now I need to go into commitment consciousness. How do I create commitment evidence to give my brain the neuromaps of commitment? And it begins to change your health, your wellness. I've done that with hundreds of patients who were in situations that were very, very difficult. And they were able to resolve it. But you have to have a partner that is willing to, what I call the guardians of the heart. You give them your heart to take care of it for you. And they give you their heart and you take care of their heart. So we don't commit to perfection. We commit to creativity in the process of loving.
This is so powerful. Two quick things. So if somebody is hitting my abandonment cord and they're showing up late and they ask, what can I do? 50 push-ups. Everybody's 50 push-ups. All right. Just putting that out there. You're doing push-ups.
Okay. Right.
I don't want to hug. Hit the ground. But also this is really speaking to the necessity for us to be more evolved. Like we think we're more evolved. Like I got an iPhone 7.
Right.
I'm evolved.
That's right.
But it's being more evolved in our awareness, really. Because when we're in these relationship contexts, we tend to be so in our body and so in blame state that we're not aware that we can instantly change our state and approach it from a more evolved perspective, you know, and not be right into the amygdala. And so it's like talking about the things that he's speaking of today, which is remembering when your partner is this upset, what is this triggering for them, right? And do they really, you know, want to throw the pie in your face? Or is it just that they're feeling this, you know, this whole history of abandonment, and it's for you to have the opportunity to remember, like, they actually do love me and they care about me that much. That's why they're upset that I'm late or whatever the case might be. And if you come from that perspective, we're just talking about a healthier relationship.
Wow.
But there's a fear there of you forfeiting your own standards.
Okay.
Right? Can you talk a little bit about
also
that?
Also, the fear of being used.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Mm-hmm. Of being manipulated. And that's the kind of thing. And you talked about the amygdala, which is really important for the audience. The amygdala is a part of the brain that actually registers fear and emotions at very primitive levels. But with functional MRIs, you can show that when people do processes similar to this, the amygdala loses some of the activity and it goes to the prefrontal lobe, to the left part of the prefrontal lobe, which has to do with the when people come out of depression and when people are in a good place. So actually you're getting brain changes when you do these things.
That's powerful.
Yeah, exactly. Mm-hmm. And you also, of course, talk about this throughout your book as well. And we've done many episodes talking about neuroplasticity and how our brain is so changeable. You know, and how these synaptic connections, like, they're always taking place, but some of them are getting more love. They're getting more myelin laid down because you're doing the thing over and over again. It's really a part of who you are. And I found that it's not necessarily trying to break down those old pathways, but building a new one, because your brain can do that. And as soon as you hear ideas like he's talking about today, you have to put it in practice, because another thing is that speed of implementation.
Yeah.
You know, like writing something down in your notebook, that notebook's just going to sit there on a shelf for a while unless you immediately do something with it, even if we have the best intentions. So that's another big thing about this show, is that this isn't about you being a human filing cabinet, right? This is about you making these things a part of who you are. And on that note, I want to talk a little bit more about so many people over the years have, and I've seen this firsthand, and of course I've seen this in my own life, but just the process of changing one's lifestyle from just kind of really being tied in to how our society is today. You know, like, I grew up on strawberry honeycomb cereal, Hot Pockets, and, like, you know, TV dinners, you know. It's like, seriously, every fast food, if I could, I would have fast food every day for every meal.
For every
And I've done it before. Mm-hmm. All right. And I've lived to tell the story, fortunately.
Right.
But so going from that to shifting over and making yourself into, you know, where you have this health habit heavy lifestyle and a healthy life affirming lifestyle, I know that both have these cultural implications. So I'd love to know why so many people struggle when they try to make the decision to get healthy. I want to dive in more and talk about that so that people can have more tools when they're making this lifestyle change to get out of the societal norm and to really step into being the best version of themselves. What can they do? Because it's really about culture first and foremost from your work.
Yes. And I think the way to break things down, Shawn, is when you're wanting to come up with a solution is to look at how these things are developed. What is the developmental process? And what happens is the culture will tell, let's say you're in a family gathering, you're breaking bread, which is a really important component of immune function ability, and you're eating junk food. Well, that junk food is associated with love. Mm. That's love.
Yeah.
Some societies, if you don't clear your plate, you don't love them. Mm-hmm. So all of that is associated in the part of the brain that has to do with the pleasure and positive things, connection with family. Then all of a sudden you say, okay, I'm not going to have this anymore. And consciously, you know that it's not good for you, but there are all kinds of other components, clusters of emotions and physiology that are there. And you have to become aware of that. Then how do you make that change? Number one, by realizing that you're a product of that culture and that it served you well for a certain amount of time. Then you don't want to go to the other extreme of replacing something you really love with something that's very bland. Because that's not going to work, as you know.
Yes.
So what you do is you find something that not replaces, but it comes as another option. When you replace something, the option that you lost gains value, the reactance theory. So what you do is you say, okay, I'm not going to eat a pie right now. I'm going to eat something that I really like. And you go to all the options of the healthy food and you find one. Once you have options, the freedom goes up. Then you don't give that other one up, but you say, okay, I am going to have it maybe once a month. I'm going to have this. And it's no big deal. I'm just going to have it. Then it reduces the value because you have given it an option. Gradually what happens is that, as you know, your taste buds become more sophisticated. And after a while, I haven't had a soda in maybe 30 years. And if I drank one now, I couldn't because of the sugar. So what you're doing is your taste buds change every few days, every 7 days. And if you give them an opportunity to adjust to new food, they will learn to like the new food. So those are,
yeah.
But you can do that with food. You can do that with relationships. You can do that with anything because the process is the same.
I remember a couple years ago that I had a drink of a cola and man, it burned. I could not believe how much it burned, like physically burnt my tongue, the inside of my mouth. And I used to drink soda all the time growing up. It's just like, wow, you force yourself to get adapted to that. And my son, Braden, he had these little different sodas or whatever at some birthday party that he had access to. And he took a drink and he's like, I don't want it. Like he just wasn't used to that. And it didn't feel pleasurable. And the same thing we do with smoking. You know, the first time you have a cigarette, it's like, your body is revolting against it, you know, like you're probably going to cough. It's every cell in your body saying, don't do this, bro.
Yeah.
Don't do this, mama,
right.
You know, but you force yourself until it becomes comfortable.
Because
you
of
know?
Culture.
Yes.
Exactly.
In connection with culture.
Mm-hmm. Yes. The culture will shape you. The culture, it's cool to smoke. So then you have to teach your lungs to not respond in a healthy way or like the diet Coke, the diet soda. The culture, the I culture has really made you believe that you're going to lose weight. What it does is it creates, and you know this better than anybody, it creates a false sense of security. People overweight will have a large meal on this. I'll have a diet Pepsi. And you know what the diet drinks do? They increase your appetite. They toxify the liver and it doesn't burn the fat. It increases your appetite. So it's a way of maintaining the product. If you actually lost weight, you wouldn't do it anymore. But what it does is it increases your appetite. It doesn't allow you to lose weight. And you have that pseudo sense of confidence that you're doing the right thing. Totally cultural.
You know, you said something so important. Like this is paradigm changing. And I want everybody to really hear this. You said that when you lose something, it gains value. So when you give up that thing, or you try to stop eating pizza or smoking, when you quit something, it gains value. Okay, inherently, it's going to gain value. So you also talk about something in the book, and what's so beautiful is that this basically echoes many things that we've talked about over the years and filling the vacuum, right? You know, the universe, it hoards a vacuum. And so when something is removed, yes, something is going to fill that space. And so if you're not conscious in filling that space with something that's of greater or equal value to that thing that you lost, it's going to be an even greater struggle. And you talk about that in your book.
Yes, and I'm glad you said that, because it reminded me of something that I would have lost if you hadn't said this. In relationships, for example, I propose that that compromises are terrible. Compromises are good for ledger relationships. Yeah. If you do this now, and you know those books that tell you make a list and what you like and your partner, that's junk. What you want to do? Why? Let's say that your partner likes football and you like soccer. If you say, okay, now 1 week we'll go to soccer. What will happen is that the week that you have to go to what you don't like, you're going to resent it and your partner's going to feel guilty, and vice versa. So what do? You allow the person to maintain their identity. I like soccer. I go to soccer, or I watch soccer by myself. Then here's the key. You create a win-win. You create something that's even better than soccer and football. You say, okay, now we're going to create a new ritual. And you give it reverence. And the new ritual is going to be that once a week, we're going to go on a picnic to a lake or whatever you decide. Then what it does is it takes away the resentment and it takes away the guilt, and you create a new ritual that is immune enhancing.
That is immune enhancing too. So then that inflammation goes down. You're not getting sick. You're going to be more attractive and more fun to be with when you go on your picnic on the beach.
Well said.
So, you know, this is something we talked about. This we had Dr. John Gray on the show, and you know, the legendary author of Men Are From Mars, Women Are From Venus, and we talked about all the different aspects that's going on in the minds and in the hearts of men and women all over the world. And there are these consistencies, and one of those things that you just mentioned, for me, it's a consistency. And we actually talked about that on the show when we had my wife Ann on, and talking about these core principles to having a really healthy, happy relationship. And I said this, that I don't like the word compromise. It's not about compromising. It's really about blending, you know, and finding ways that there can be a happiness or a win-win-win across the board for these things, rather than sacrificing in the name of, like, in the dirty version of sacrifice, which is giving up something that's of joy to you and doing something that you don't want to do. And versus the good word, that the good name that we give sacrifice, which is to make sacred, you know, which are two different things. But we use the dirty version in the context of a relationship and wonder why there's so much suffering.
Right.
You know,
right.
There will be times, of course, that you're going to do things you might not necessarily want to do. That's the nature of life, right? But you can make that in the minority. Some people are living it daily, all right? And you don't want to fall into that camp. And one other thing I wanted to ask you about, in the book you talk about, we need to differentiate between having an illness and becoming an illness. And I think this is really an important topic. So can you talk a little bit about that?
Yes, because if you identify yourself with anything, a diabetic or even an alcoholic, what you do is you develop an identity based on something that is not as much as you are. You're much more than an alcoholic. You're much more than a diabetic. And even a diabetic, your blood sugar is not up all the time. It goes up and down based on context. There's been a lot of research on that. So you have an illness or a condition that is a transitional process. At this point, we don't have the cure for something. For example, where 100 years, there were over 100 illnesses that were terminal, and they're not anymore. So hope is very important. You have a condition that they haven't found the cure for first, and you're much more than the condition. And as you become much more than the condition, you get away from those support groups that let's support the HIV positive, let's support diabetes. It doesn't work well, because what you're doing is you're identifying yourself with the illness. Now, if you're a diabetic and you want to identify with something that will help you, identify with diabetics who are not into diabetes, or identify with people that do things that are completely incompatible with diabetes. So, but you hear people talk about illnesses, it's like they're going to Tahiti. oh, my doctor said, well, my doctor said, well, he's going to have this surgery, and it becomes, and it's good for the medical profession, but it's terrible for the immune system.
Dr. Martinez, this has been very, very enlightening. I've got one final question for you, and I'm interested to hear your answer. You know, this is the Model Health Show, so we're providing people with a model. We're providing people with a principle, a standard, a way of being that they can replicate in their own lives to get the results that they want to have. So I'm curious, what is the model that you're here to set with the way that you're living your life personally?
Well, the first thing is to remember that we are the recipients of 150,000 years of wisdom that is there. You don't have to think about how you're digesting the food or how you're processing your thoughts. It's there. Knowing that, also being aware that the causes of health are already built in, they're there, and that illnesses are transitional in many cases, and that only about 2 or 3% of the illnesses are really completely genetically passed on, and the rest are learned. We learn illnesses, not consciously, but we learn to bring out the genes that express the illness. But what we need to learn is to bring out the genes that express your health. You can't change your DNA, but you can change the expression of your genes. So if you have an illness, for example, you have a family illness, which is a myth, then they say, well, if you have diabetes in the family, you're going to be a diabetic. No, that's not true. You have a propensity for diabetes, and the evidence comes because people live together, they eat together, they think together, and they have a diabetes consciousness. But what can you do? You look at outliers in the family that are not diabetic, and how do they live, and how are they different? Those people are exercising the causes of health. The others are exercising the causes of illness.
Excellent. And I think that people That's can so follow the causes of health by following you and how you live your life. So thank you so much for sharing that.
My pleasure. And thank you for your work.
Oh, thank you. It's my pleasure. It's my pleasure. Can you let everybody know where they can find your book and where they can connect with you online?
Yes. From March 21st, the book will be available everywhere. Amazon is the best place, but you can get them at bookstores and anywhere. And it's called The Mind, Body, Self. And for more information, you can go to biocognitive.com. There's quite a bit of free stuff there, as well as you had mentioned earlier, Shawn, that some of your audience is interested in the research. There's all kinds of articles on the website, as well as an extensive bibliography in the book and a glossary for the new terms.
Perfect. Perfect. Tools. Dr. Martinez, you are, in fact, the man. I appreciate you so much for sharing your gift and for doing this work.
Thank you. My pleasure. And thank you for having me.
It is our pleasure. Everybody, thank you so much for tuning into the show today. I hope you got a lot of value out of this. And this is about changing your paradigm, mm-hmm. you know, and realizing that these are just tiny little specks in the grand scheme of things, and you having the results that you truly want. It really starts with you changing your mind. It really starts with you being aware of how culture, your culture, is influencing your actions, your thoughts, and your behaviors, because it can be really like trying to run uphill constantly to change your practices with your exercise, to change your practices with your nutrition, with your sleep, with your relationships. If you're not aware of the fact of how your culture has influenced all of these decisions that you're making in your life, and awareness is really power. Awareness is really an opening of possibility, and it really trumps everything. Once you begin to become aware that these things are influencing you, you now have the opportunity to work on them and to change them. But if you just don't know what you don't know, it's just like, why do I keep doing this? Why do I keep doing that? And you don't wake up to the fact of, wait a minute, this is my environment. These are the people that I've been around. These are people that I grew up around. These are the people that I'm around now. How is that influencing my behavior? Because that is imbued into the culture. And it's not just the culture of people you know personally, but the people you engage with online, the people that you engage with when you go out to different places, he mentioned sports earlier, you know, going to the soccer game versus the football game. You know, every environment that you get into is influencing you in your thought process and your actions. You know, you might find that I'm straight, like I eat clean all the time. When I go out to the, you know, to the soccer game or the American football game, I just get hammer timed. Like I get hammer timed times 10, yeah. Right? And it's just waking up to that fact of like, well, wait a minute, if this is who, if that's not who you want to be, maybe you want to change your environment. Maybe you want to just watch the game at home. I don't know, invite some people over, yeah, change your behavior a little bit. Mm-hmm. But that's just a very small example in the grand scheme of things. It's just, again, about becoming more and more aware of how the culture is influencing your actions, because there is a dense amount of science proving that this is, in fact, one of the major driving forces for your immune system, for your genetic expression. And that's why I was excited to bring Dr. Mario Martinez on the show for you today.
He is awesome.
So last thing I want to touch on for you guys was the importance of understanding that having an illness and not becoming an illness.
Yes.
We've talked about this many times because when you label yourself as when this incredible, important term, this important quote to remember, when you label me, you negate me. Mm-hmm. When you label me, you negate me. And how often do we negate ourselves by saying, I am diabetic, I am fill in the blank, you know, whatever the case might be for you. I am, I'm depressed. I am a single mother, you know, and as soon as you put that label on yourself, you isolate yourself and you become that thing when it's just, it's a symptom, right? It's a part of the experience. It's a category, it's a cluster of symptoms, but you are far more than that. And when you take the label off, you give yourself more of an opportunity to change.
Yeah, it takes the confines off.
Yes, and so you can say,
confines.
I am in this situation where I have blood sugar issues. You know, I have this blood sugar condition that I'm working with to shift and to change.
Yeah.
You know, so just remember that and how powerful your words are in your own mind, and also how you allow people to speak to you as well. You know, so that's very, very important. So I wanted to really just hammer that point home, that when you label yourself, you negate yourself and allow yourself to be free of the labels so that you are better equipped to take the action necessary to have the results that you desire and deserve. Everybody, thank you again for tuning into the show today. We've got so many amazing things coming up. Make sure to share the show out with your friends on Twitter, Facebook, Instagram.
That's right.
You can tag me at Shawn Model, and I appreciate you so much. Take care, have an amazing day, and I'll talk with you soon.